Okay, let's go. So I'll begin with what I guess will be the last of this series of example that I gave. So this is a manifold that Sylvain has mentioned, and it is modeled on the Heisenberg group. So let's put M. So well, maybe that's a group. Let's call that G. X, Y, Z, 1, 1. So that's the group of upper triangular 3 by 3 matrices with 1 on the diagonal. And okay, so 3 by 3 matrices are a bit. So this is the 3D Heisenberg group. So I'll denote by G sub Z the same guy, except that the entries are now in Z3. Okay. Okay, and so the manifold we will be chiefly interested in is G mod GZ. So that's a 3 manifold whose fundamental group is this group GZ. And we will try to see what kind of metrics we will put on them. But first, maybe we will try a little bit to analyze its topology. Okay, so, well, 3 by 3 matrices is too big. We will concentrate on that. And the group law on G, when you write things this way, is the following. So you multiply x, y, z by some guy, x prime, y prime, z prime, and it gives you x plus x prime, y plus y prime. So on these first two coordinates, it just look like usual R2. Then it's almost R3, so z plus z prime. And you get some kind of twist, plus y z prime. OK. So now we can play a little bit, like assume that the guy on the left is as integer coefficient and acts here. And we will see that the unit cube is a fundamental domain of the action of G sub Z. So yeah, we only need to understand what's going on in that cube to see really what's going on. Okay, so let's try to make a picture. So here will be my x. My y will be this axis, and my z will be here. So, and we will work inside the unit cube. So, okay. Let's try to look at what's going on when we act by, like, so this group GZ is generated by the guy where you have only one of the integer equal to 1 and the other is equal to 0. Maybe I can call those guys. So I will call A to be 1 0, 0, B to be 0, 1, 0, and C to be 0, 0, 1. Okay, so that's a system of generators of this GZ group. Okay, so what's going on? So if I take the origin, so if I act by A, so it will come here. So yeah, maybe I'll try to take some meaningful color code. So blue lines will mean action by A. So this would be A. Orange will be action by B. So where does the origin go by B? Just goes here, and by Z, it goes right there. Okay, now let's try to see what becomes of this guy. So if I act once again by Z, I will leave the fundamental domain. So that's not that interesting. So now, if I look at what happens to this guy and I act by A, I arrive here. And if I act, So I think, not mistaken. And I guess if I act by B, not quite. That's where things get interesting. Okay, so if I act by B on that guy, I end up here. Okay. So, and if I act by, so that's Z on that guy, I will just go up a little bit. Left, I guess. So did I miss one? Okay, so which one is the, on which one did I make a mistake? Because that can happen.
The orange line
section
by B on the
front node. On which one? B on this one?
Yes.
Okay, so.
Because of the YZ prime.
And that's the wrong group law. That's right. That X, Y prime. I guess that's better like this. Okay. Well, so that's a start. So now, if I act by Z on this guy, 0. So there are 2 zeros in the first entry, so that guy won't interfere. So that's not too bad. Okay. Now, and this is where the fun starts. What's going on with this guy? So let's act with A. So that's A. So let me make times. So this is B, actually. And if I'm not mistaken, I end up to 1, 1, 1. X, Y prime. Yes. OK, so when I act by, so I act by A on this guy. OK. So I end up. I end up here, actually. So I've acted by A, so I guess that's a blue line. OK. Which actually can be identified with this one. OK. And actually, if I do that here, I will end up like that. So what's going on? So each of the slices here is mapped to some torus here. Maybe let's see what's going on here. So, and this, okay, green guy. So we have shifted up this way. So what you can get from this picture is the following. So if I slice this way, what I get is, and just identify what I can do on that guy, what I guess is 0, 1 times some tori T2, which are the vertical slices here. But when I arrive here, I glue the two faces back. So this triangle is actually mapped here because of the group action, but through some, not through the identity, but through some other diffeomorphism. So this is T2. And the action I get is zero YZ is identified with one. So YZ plus Y. So that's what is called, that's one example of a mapping torus, actually, if I didn't make mistake. So you have an interval cross a torus. You choose some diffeomorphism of the torus. And you glue back the two ends of your manifold with this diffeomorphism. Here, the diffeomorphism is pretty simple, so that gives you somehow a simple manifold. But if you take a really complicated diffeomorphism, you can get other kinds of manifolds. And I guess if you take a pseudo Anosov, you get an hyperbolic manifold. That's it? Yeah. OK. But here, OK. So yeah, maybe that's the picture one should keep in mind. I won't draw any more arrows on that picture because that will become a complete mess. But I hope it helps. So let's build a metric, and actually several of them. So let's build some metrics on G. And they will be left invariant metrics. And this guy acts by isometries. So that won't, so that will give metrics on the quotient. So So first, I'll select some basis of the tangent space at the identity. Well, that's R3. So it's easy. So I'll take just dx, dy, dz to be the standard basis of R3. And I'll set x yz to be, so these are, we have a Lie group here. So I'll take left invariant vector fields. Variant with, well, so x at 0, the origin of R3 is dx, y at 0 is dy, and z at 0 is dz. It's a good exercise to compute those vector fields. And then you can show the following. We have that So when you take the Li bracket of x and y, you get z. Yeah. When you take the Li bracket of xz and of yz, you get zero. So is that 2z in that case? No, that's okay. No, I guess that's z with that convention. So that's actually, so z commutes with every other element of the Li algebra. So that's actually the center. So the vector space generated by z is actually the center of this Li algebra. And so big Z, so in German, would stand for the Zentrum. And here, little c goes with center, so we are in good shape. And the construction I'm going to make is actually can actually be made on a lot on all nilpotent Li groups. Okay, so set G A B C such that so X Y Z is an orthogonal frame at each point. And so then so I will ask x to have length alpha, y to have length beta, and z to have length gamma. OK, so now if you like it, you can play the game of computing covariant derivatives and curvature, or you can look up in books. Yeah?
Alpha, beta, and gamma are ABC, or?
No, ABC are vectors, and these are real numbers.
But the metric is given by JABC, so it's J alpha.
Yeah, OK, here. Sorry. Yeah, I noticed midway that ABC were used there. Alpha, beta, gamma. OK. So OK, you can play the game of computing curvatures, and you will get the following stuff. Every curvature, so whichever you like, sectional, Ricci curvature, at least evaluated on some unit vector, scalar curvature, is a multiple, some universal constant, of gamma squared over alpha squared times beta squared. OK, so you can play this game. And you can actually play this game with like bigger nilpotent Li groups with nested ideals and stuff like that. And you will get this kind of formulas. Okay, so but that's really interesting because we can have the metric degenerating, like losing, like those guy, the length of those vectors going to zero while keeping the curvature bounded if we choose alpha, beta, and gamma wisely. So for instance, so if I set G epsilon, epsilon, okay, and epsilon squared. So what's going on when epsilon goes to zero? So well, everything shrinks. And so it Gromov-Hausdorff converges. So that would be m and that. So and in Gromov-Hausdorff sense, we converge to a point. And more interestingly, that's why the epsilon squared, the sectional curvature here is bounded of my metric G epsilon, epsilon, epsilon squared. OK, so and actually, there's a theorem of Gromov, which tell you, so this is the almost flat manifold theorem, which tells you that if you have a manifold which carry a sequence of metrics where as I go to infinity, the sequence of manifolds, Gromov-Hausdorff converges to a point, and at the same time, along the sequence, the sectional curvature stays bounded, then more or less you're in that kind of situation. Maybe you need to take some finite cover, but there's a nilpotently group lurking around. And at least the topology of M will look like some quotient of some nilpotently group. Okay. But actually, yeah, exercise. So we can play a lot of other games with that. So what kind of bound on the curvature do we have for each of these metrics as epsilon go to 0? And to what should they converge? Actually, from this, so yeah, from this description, we see the ciphered fibered structure here. We have those circles everywhere. OK, so let me start the second blackboard. So I've been talking about Gromov-Hausdorff convergence for now 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, and I haven't stated any theorem so far, so maybe I should start. So first a theorem, and then I move on to the next topic. Maybe a last definition. So, an epsilon net in a metric space X, B is a set of points. So X1, well, Xi, let's say, for I in I, such that, so first, the balls B, Xi, epsilon are disjoint. And second, the balls, yeah, maybe let's keep things symmetric. B, Xi, 2 epsilon cover X. So basically, you try to pack as many possible, as many balls as possible of radius epsilon. And you start, you stop when you, when it cannot be, when you cannot put another ball inside. So why is that interesting? Basically, the inclusion of this set of points Xi into X with that kind of stuff is an epsilon approximation. So that, so this is, this set with the induced distance from X is Gromov-Hausdorff epsilon close to the metric space XD. So I won't go into details about that, but that's actually an important method of proof when you study Gromov-Hausdorff convergence, is to get back to finite sets. Okay. So now a theorem. So yeah, let me state it. For pointed convergence, Okay. Just to be sure about the statement, it would be a nice improvement. Okay. So let xi di xi naught be a sequence of pointed metric spaces and so then such that for every epsilon, for every r, there exists some big N of epsilon r such that in each so in each ball centered at xi naught of radius r, so this is a ball in xi centered at xi naught and of radius r, one can find an epsilon net with at most big N of epsilon r points. So this is the hypothesis of the theorem. Then, up to a subsequence, xi di xi naught Gromov-Hausdorff converges in a pointed sense to some limit space x d x naught. Okay. So I won't prove that, but the idea is to prove something for finite metric spaces and then to apply it along the sequence to epsilon net. It's a bit tedious to write properly, but it works. So, yeah. And now, in the rest of this lecture, what I will do is I will show a corollary of this fact. So let min gi pi be a sequence of, so these are Riemannian manifolds, such that such that the Ricci curvature of each of these manifolds is greater than, well, up to normalization, up to scaling, you can always assume that you have that. You can replace that by, you can put some k here, but that doesn't matter. Then, up to a subsequence, well, so this is, so now this is the Riemannian distance coming from this, and this go to some x d, p now, why not, in pointed Gromov-Hausdorff sense. Okay, so this is, well, this or this is Gromov's compactness theorem. So one of the main advantages of Gromov-Hausdorff convergence is that you get converging subsequences really cheaply. So it's like in functional analysis. When you study weak convergence, well, you get some limit. It's hard to say sometimes whether it's actually related to the sequence you started with. Here, the situation is similar. There are some better notion of convergence, like when you have two-sided curvature bounds, lower volume bounds, injectivity radius bounds, and stuff like that. And that gives you really precise control of how the convergence is taking place. So you will have convergence on under this stronger assumption at the level of the Riemannian metric itself. But it's pretty hard in some application to verify the hypothesis. Here, well, you have some kind of very weak convergence, but you have a lot of compact sets. So that's a usual trade-off. The more compact set you have, the harder it is to say something about your limit. But actually here, and this will be the, we will try to say stuff on that. Here we have Ricci curvature bound. So remember, this is the Laplacian of the metric. We have a lower bound on that. So it's some kind of subharmonic property. And when you have convergence of subharmonic function, even if the convergence is pretty weak, you can say something about the limit. It will be subharmonic in some weak sense, and that can be a great help. So, well, that's why, even though we only have Gromov-Hausdorff convergence, we will be able to say some stuff under this hypothesis on the limit metric space here. So I will tell you only about a few stuff, but now we actually know a pretty good deal about what's going on this kind of limit spaces. Okay, so now, yeah, and I will explain why in the next chapter. It's a corollary of Bishop-Gromov inequality, which I will prove. Okay. Okay. So three. So comparison. Geometry. With Ricci curvature bounds. So, and it will start with our most advanced tool so far on Riemannian manifolds, which is Buckner's formula. And we will prove from that the Laplacian comparison theorem. Okay, so should I state the theorem or prove it first? Maybe let's state it first. So I'll define some function, which I call cot sub k. So it's a cotangent with an index of r will be equal to the cotangent. So yeah, I need to be careful not to mess up the stuff. So basically, this is what the Laplacian of the metric is on constant curvature spaces. So where is that? Okay, so that square root of k cotangent. So cotangent is cosine square root of k r over sine square root of k r. So that's when k is positive. So when k is equal to 0, it's actually pretty simple. It's 1 over r. When k is equal to 0, and then you put a minus so that you can take the square root. You take the hyperbolic variant of everyone. Okay. So, and remark. So in a manifold they're simply connected on the model space, really. Of curvature K. So this is a computation I actually made for the case of the sphere, I guess. Laplacian R is equal to n minus 1 cot k of R. Okay. So now let's state the theorem. So assume MNG is complete. And the Ricci curvature of G is greater than n minus 1 kg. Then for every p, so we have the following inequality. So Laplacian of the distance from p to some point is less or equal than n minus 1 cot k of the same function. And where is this valid? So that's part of the game. So at least we need to be outside of P. Otherwise, the Laplacian doesn't really make sense. So on M minus P. And so for the proof I'll be giving, we will need to be outside of the cut locus of P. So it's actually pretty important to say that this bound holds in some weak sense when you reach the cut locus. But I guess I'll skip the proof. So the proof is in my notes. You have actually several weak sense in which this estimate holds. And I sent a Dropbox link to my note to Gérard, which will put that on the website of the summer school. So you can look at it, and it's actually quite interesting. And this kind of weak bounds will allow us to use maximum principle and integration by parts and those kind of stuff pretty freely. Maybe a corollary first. So if F is, so I guess the optimal hypothesis is that. Yeah. Smooth. So F is a real variable function. Is smooth n non-decreasing, then what? Then the Laplacian of f composed with d is less than what it would be in the constant curvature space form. Maybe let's give a name to those. We'll call them Sn sub k, so like the sphere, but of constant curvature k. So the Laplacian here is in Sz mod Sn of k, and here the distance is also in Sn of k of some fixed point. So that's a function of the distance, and what that means is that this gives you, with the symmetries of the constant curvature space form, since it's rotationally symmetric, as we have seen when we wrote the metric, this gives you a one variable function. And when you apply this one variable function to that, you get the inequality. OK, so why is that a corollary? Well, basically, so proof of the corollary, just computation. F composed with D. So this will be the divergence of the gradient of F composed with D. And you compute it the usual way. So this is somehow cheating wherever things are not smooth. So gradient D. Oh. Okay. So and this is equal to f second of d. Gradient d squared plus f prime of d Laplace d. So this won't pose a problem because the gradient of d is always one. So when we put that, when we do the same computation here, this guy will cancel. And oh. Ah, that's better. OK, and with the sign hypothesis on F, that goes. OK, but well, the important stuff is that. So let's prove that. And what is the tool we have at our disposal? It's Buchner's formula. OK. OK, so proof of the theorem. So Buchner's formula. So assume the distance function is smooth, and we are working only on that part. So when it's smooth, its gradient is just this radial vector field with a unit norm. So apply Buchner's formula to what? To the following, to R, which is equal to the distance to P. OK, so gradient R as norm 1. So we get that 0 is equal to gradient Laplace R gradient R plus Hessian of R squared plus Ricci of gradient R gradient R. OK, who are those guys? So this So let's assume that we are following one direction. So I'm in the injectivity domain. I have the origin. And I'm following this. So I'm following a geodesic. So this is dr. So this is the derivative of Laplacian r in the direction of gradient r. So this is dr of Laplacian r. OK. Well, maybe I should do it. The notation starts to be confusing. So let assume that C of t is some geodesic with C of 0 equal to p. So this is, when you read that in normal coordinate, this is this guy. And this is just d over dt of Laplacian r, which is some function, composed with C of t. OK? So now, what do we do with that guy? So what's going on when you compute the Hessian of the distance function in the direction of this dr vector field, in the direction of gradient r? Well, then what's going on is that r grows linearly because it's the distance to the point. So when you differentiate it two times, you get nothing. So that tells you that there is a zero eigenvalue inside this Hessian. So we can get something more from the, so we can trick a little bit the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality to get a better constant. So, and that will tell us the following. This will be bigger than 1 over n minus 1 times the trace of that guy. So the Laplacian of r squared. And now what can we say about this guy? Well, this is greater than k times n minus 1. OK, so 0 is greater than that. Plus that, plus that. Nice. So that's an ODE. That's good. Okay, so that's 0, which is greater. 0 is greater than Laplacian r composed with C of t. Take the derivative of that, plus 1 over n minus 1 Laplacian r squared, plus k times n minus 1. Now, I let you end the proof yourself, but two facts that you will use for that. First, as t goes to 0, Laplacian r is equivalent to n minus 1 over r. It's just a statement that on a Riemannian manifold at small scale, everything behaves in the same way as in Euclidean space. And two, so cot n minus 1 cot k, so is a solution to the ODE that's lurking around here. So let's write it u second u prime plus u squared over n minus 1 plus k times n minus 1 equals 0. And from that, so yeah, maybe I can tell you a little more. Well, basically, you integrate stuff. you write that as an inequality and you integrate stuff, and that tells you that Laplacian R composed with C of t is less or equal than n minus 1 cot k of t, which is exactly what we wanted to prove. OK? So, OK, that was just Bochner's formula. Now let's give some applications of that. I will give two applications today and a third one tomorrow. So first is Meyer's theorem. So if you already had followed some lecture on differential geometry, you've probably seen this theorem. But it's usually not proved. Well, it depends on your teacher, I guess. But it's not always proved with that kind of stuff, because it follows from the second variation formula, too. But here we can get that without developing ever the theory of Jacobi fields and stuff like that. So, OK. So the statement is, so if MNG satisfies, is complete, that's important, N satisfies satisfies what? That the distance, the Ricci curvature of G is greater than n minus 1 G. Oops. Then, so the diameter of M G is less than pi. So that tells you that something which is more curved than the sphere has to be smaller, which is quite natural. Moreover, I won't prove the equality case, but it's a nice proof. Go look at it. So if the diameter of MNG is equal to pi, then MNG is isometric to the standard sphere. So, say this is the standard metric of radius 1. So yeah. So first, let's prove that, and you will see it's really easy. So consider proof. Consider two points P in Q, P and Q in M. So yeah, I think I never defined the diameter, so it's, well, it's something that makes sense for metric space, so I guess I don't need that. So I take 2 points the furthest apart. So such that the Riemannian distance between P and Q is equal to the diameter of MG. Now, so we've seen that between every 2 points in a complete Riemannian manifold, this is where completeness is used, there is a minimizing geodesic. So let C of t be a minimizing G geodesic from P to Q, and let's say of unit speed. And now let us consider what's going on. So let us look at r equal to the distance from P to our varying point. So when I'm inside the minimizing geodesic starting from P, I'm outside of the cut locus of P, so the distance function is smooth. So I can apply my Laplacian comparison theorem. So I can say that the Laplacian of R along C of t will be less or equal than n minus 1. So here we have k equal 1 case, cot k, cot 1, so cotangent of R, but this is R evaluated along C of t, so this is the distance from P. Yeah? Oh, that's a good question. Well, yeah. So let's assume that that wheel works exactly the same way. So strictly greater than pi. So if the diameter is greater than pi, whether it is bounded or infinite, then I have 2 points which satisfy it. And that will do the trick. OK, so cotangent of r of c of t. So, but this is the distance from p to c of t. So it's a unit speed geodesic, which is minimizing, at least until q. So this is equal to n minus 1 cotangent of t. And this goes to minus infinity as t goes to pi. So it's cosine of a cosine. No, it's cosine of a sine. Yeah. So when you're here, well, if the diameter was greater than pi, then your function would have been smooth, and you would have no trouble computing its Laplacian. So here we get that, we get a contradiction. Well, can anybody tell me? Does anybody have a counterexample when the manifold is not complete? Well, the Ricci curvature is not greater than k minus 1, than n minus 1 j. No? Well, that's actually something quite I like, so let me tell you. So you take the round sphere. Yes, it is a round sphere. Don't ask. Now you remove two spherical caps. So this has constant sectional curvature 1. So OK, so the Ricci curvature satisfies my hypothesis. So you remove these spherical caps. And you take coverings of that. So I'm not sure what the exact diameter will be, probably the length, half of the length of the curve, of the lift of the meridian curve. But if you take coverings of higher and higher and higher degree, it will go to infinity. And our curvature assumption is always perfectly satisfied. OK, so for the rigidity case, so here, this case, So the proof is quite similar to what we did this morning on Obata's theorem. So I won't redo that. You play with, basically you take 2 points where the diameter is achieved. You take RP and RQ, distance from P and distance from Q. Take the sum of both. And you can show that this is actually constant and equal to pi. But this allows you to get two-sided control on the Laplacian, because RP will be equal to, so if RP plus RQ is a constant, then Laplacian of RP is minus Laplacian of RQ. So you can play with both sides, and then you see that you have equality there, and the Hessian is nice. And when you know a lot about the Hessian of a function, you can build the manifold. That's basically the idea. For the details, so see Peterson's Riemannian geometry. Okay, so that was our first test case to see that these methods based on the Buckner formula can give us the classical results of Riemannian geometry. So now let's move to our main aim here, which will be related to this Gromov compactness theorem. It is the Bishop-Gromov comparison theorem. So Bishop-Gromov. Well, I guess Myers is supposed to be part two of the chapter, and Bishop-Gromov will be part three. Okay. So this is volume comparison. So I haven't really talked about volume, but we've talked about volume element. So I need to define some function. So let Vk of R be the volume of a ball of radius R. So this will depend on the dimension, but when it's clear, I won't put the n here. Inside what? Inside the space form, so what I'll call Sn sub k. So V0 of R is just the volume of a ball of radius R. So it's something times R to the power n. And yeah. So it's more or less up to some constant, it's the integral of so I define cot k, could have defined sine k. So it's the integral of sine k times to the power n minus 1 from 0 to r. Okay. So now let's state the theorem. And let's take a new blackboard to do that. I guess I want to keep the Laplacian comparison, so I'll keep that here. So theorem, Bishop-Gromov. So let M and G be a complete manifold with Ricci curvature greater than k times n minus 1 times g. Then, so for every p, where P inside M, the function which maps R to, so well, the volume of the ball in M of center P of radius R over V sub K of R is non-increasing. Okay. Remark. So, as I repeatedly told you, when you look at a Riemannian manifold at small scale, what you see is Euclidean space. So, for R really small, this will be almost the volume of a Euclidean ball, and the same for that, since it is the volume of a ball inside some Riemannian manifold. So, remark. So, the volume of BPR over V sub K of R goes to 1 as R goes to 0. So, and it's non-increasing. So it will always be less than 1. And from that, you get a useful estimate sometimes, which is that the volume of BPR is always less than V sub K of R. OK, so balls cannot grow too fast. But what's interesting is that when you have some kind of information about what's going on for R big, so for instance, if you know the volume of your manifolds and you know its diameter, you know that when R is the diameter, here you get something that you can control. So that way you also get a lower bound on the volume. So that's a really interesting tool. OK, let's prove the theorem. So for this, so this won't be a full-fledged rigorous proof, but I guess you're getting used to it. But nevertheless, I guess the main idea is here. OK. So recall, that Laplacian of R is the mean curvature of the sphere of radius R around P. Of course, once again, R is the distance from P. OK, what Laurent told us this morning is that mean curvature measures the variation of the area. So that tells us that let A of PR be the derivative, so not the derivative, but the area of the sphere of radius R around P so Laurent, did you talk of mean curvature as a vector or as a number?
As a vector.
As a vector. OK. So Laplacian R times gradient R here is the mean curvature vector. Maybe with a minus. It depends on the convention. Well, anyway, the formula I'm going to write is almost true. So I differentiate that with respect to R. I'm cheating a lot. But I guess the main idea is here. Yeah, but because once you reach the cut locus, it's not clear what one should do. Actually, one should see what's going on along each geodesic, and then try to glue this all together. But the main idea is this one. So it's the integral. So let's call that, so it's the boundary of the ball. Well, no, that's too much cheating, I guess. Of SPR, so of the mean curvature. So dV SPR. Okay. So this is just saying that this is the mean curvature. So actually, the mean curvature, as Laurent defined it, would be Laplacian R times gradient R. So here we would have inner product of Laplacian R gradient R times the variation vector field. But when you move a sphere like that, what is the variation vector field? It's just gradient R. And since we are cheating, we can assume that everything is smooth, so that gradient R is norm 1. Okay, so this is less or equal than integral over SPR of cot k of R with an n minus 1 times this dvspr. But this function, so it's constant on my manifold. So I can get it out of the integral. So that's cot k of r over my n minus 1 times apr. OK. So guess that not. So what am I missing? Okay, that's perfect. Ah, yeah. So now let's play the same game inside our space of constant curvature k. And set AK to be of R to be the area of a radius R sphere inside our comparison space. Then one could show that we actually have equality here. Ak prime of R, oh, and this Ak actually, well, it's Vk prime. No big deal. So Ak prime is equal to n minus 1 cot k of R times Ak. Now let us consider the same thing. Actually, that could be a separate theorem, which has its interest. So instead of volume, we compare area of distant sphere. I take APR over AK of PR. So I leave up to you to compute the derivative of that, and to show that it's negative. With this and this, it's really easy. And then we use a Well, a calculus trick, actually. That's no more than that. So we have that the theorem is true for area. So now, I have 5 minutes late. Okay, so there's a calculus trick. Look at the notes if you want to know. Which tells you that if f over g is non-increasing, then integral of f over integral of g will also be non-increasing. Okay, so now let's look at this corollary. Let's try to prove that from Bishop-Gromov. So yeah, I'll try not to be too formal. But nevertheless, I write something. Otherwise, it's really cheating. So we have that the volume of a ball of radius r, say small r, let's assume that epsilon is some small radius, and that r is some big radius that will play the role of the epsilon and big r appearing here. So it's volume of p epsilon over k epsilon. So it decreases. So it's volume of b pr over vk of r. Now let me twist that a little bit and write that volume of bp epsilon over volume of bpr is greater than vk of epsilon over vk of r. So epsilon is a priori, like, you should think of that as really small and r as probably really big, but they are fixed. So that guy is some strictly positive fraction. And this here takes you that each time you put a ball of radius epsilon inside your big ball of radius r, you eat some small but definite portion of the volume. So you can put only a finite number. I guess I'll mess things up if I'm trying to put like floor functions and seal and stuff like that to say what this exact number is, and that's not that interesting. But that's why the corollary is a corollary of the theorem once you know the Bishop-Gromov volume estimate. Yeah? Oh, yeah, there's a. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, you need to split things. I don't remember how you do that, actually, on top of my head. VKR. Do you remember how it works? So you can more or less prove that when you follow a geodesic, the volume of a ball decays at most exponentially when you have a lower bounds on the Ricci curvature. So I guess that's a way to do it. But for me, it was simpler. Or maybe there's some trick on like putting some balls inside balls of radius r over 2. And
yeah, you take a ball of radius 2r.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, every ball of radius r will be inside the big ball of radius 2r. So, yeah. So, well, it was really too much cheating, I guess. OK. I leave it up to you to implement the real proof as Laurent said. It was really too fast with that. Okay, 3 minutes left. Questions? Comments? Requests? Complaints? Okay, so have a nice last seminar which we will not attend, I guess.